Now we're going to have a more application-oriented is how to sign your images with some word I don't really understand.
PKCS 11.
Suck at crypto. And Jan will.
Yeah. So if you want to look at a little bit more code than I have on my slides, go to my GitHub thing. There is a layer-like thing which is not usable as a layer because there's no layer conf, but it has some example code which I'm going to show, and then you can tell me if it's a bad idea or not. So about me, I'm an embedded software engineer since a few years, started with OpenMoko, and now work at Pangotronics, did the ROC update tool together with Enrico, and I'm also working on the LabGrid testing framework. So yeah, some of you may know Pangotronics. We do embedded Linux stuff below the application, basically everything, and have a few patches in the Linux kernel. So yeah. Why sign code? Who here thinks they don't want to sign their code? 2, 3, 4, 5? In a few cases, it might make sense if you don't have...
how hard is it?
I hope I'll make it easier. So, yeah. So if you deploy systems that run in the fields, are accessible not only by your friendly users, but maybe some adversaries, you have maybe video cameras at your front door that run Linux and are accessible from the outside and they're connected to your network and maybe have access to your alarm system or something like that. You might want to make sure that they only run the code you want. So for systems that are network connected, you know they will be broken at some point in the future by some remote exploit, and you might want to be able to recover them. So if you don't have any code signing, the attacker will override your bootloader configuration, and yeah, you can keep updating them, but you will never be sure that you actually own the system again. So something new, the European Union is starting to regulate software for embedded devices and things like making sure that they can be recovered, that they are trustable from the outside, seems to be getting into regulations. So sooner or later we need to think about how to actually do that. So our common use cases we have at Pangotronics is that we want to have signing during development as well, because we want to test the whole chain. Otherwise, it will just break at the customer. And before the release, we want to make sure that the release software is authenticatable by the devices in the field. So there is already some existing support in Open Embedded for that. The U-boot signing class supports that via fit images. And yeah, U-boot supports that for a long time. We have something similar in Barebox, but that's not supported by OE. And it's only very specific for U-boot. So you have to have custom configuration in your BSP layer to sign kernel images so U-boot can authenticate them. And then you don't have covered kernel modules, the bootloader itself, and all that stuff. And you can't easily switch which keys you're using to sign that, because you want to have different keys for development and for release, for example. We have support in MetaRauch for signing bundles, because that's also for updating. It's pretty important to make sure that's actually authentic. And there's a MetaSecure core layer. The maintainer has a lot of different technologies supported for basically x86 systems with TPMs and so on. But to me, it looks more or less like an exploration of these different technologies than something built to be reusable in a project or a product context. And all of these access keys differently and are configured differently. So it's not nice to use them in a single project. Yeah, they store the keys to sign the artifacts as simple files in your file system, sometimes even to be stored in the BSP itself. So anyone who has access to this key can copy it, and you won't even know that the key has been compromised. And as I said, different roles. So you, for example, you have your BSP developer who builds images, and have someone else who has the authority to sign releases. So that's not really supported in these cases. So what's PKCS11? It's a, I think, over 10-year-old standard to access cryptographic material on tokens. These tokens can be different things. They can be YubiKeys, smart cards, TPMs, trusted execution environments, software security modules, and software emulators exist as well. So it's a standard API to use cryptographic material to create it, but you can't extract it from the PKCS11 token. So you can give someone a token, they can sign a release with that, take it back, and you know that they did not make a copy of it. So on tokens, you have keys. The spec calls them objects. Those are identified via URIs, so they start with PKCS11, and then you have some sort of filter specification where the PKCS11 library then can search for the correct key if you have several of them. So this PKCS11 standard is implemented by basically all of the hardware security module vendors. There are OpenSSL engines for that, so there's pretty wide support for that by now. OpenSSL supports it, GNU/TLS, OpenVPN can use it to access keys on smart cards in the TPM and so on. And the most important point, it's usage only, you can't extract the key via this interface. So if anything is unclear, please wave at me, I'll try to explain it again. Otherwise, questions are probably best left for later. So in OE, we want to, I want to profit from that. I want to support hardware tokens, so I don't have the problem of having a USB stick with a key that I take out of my safe to sign a release and then hope that during this time nobody makes a copy. So yeah, I want to make sure that I keep control of my release signing keys. I want to decouple key configuration from key usage to reuse existing recipes with different keys. So for example, my BSP layer could support an option that I sign my bootloader, sign my kernel, and so on, but it doesn't specify which exact key to use, and I could put that later in via my localconf or in an additional layer. And I want to do it in a way that I have the same signing mechanisms during development and during release, so I can test the full path on my desk without accessing the top secret keys I want to keep in my safe. So the usual components I want to authenticate are the ROM, but I don't need to do anything for that because that's burned into my socks, so I can be pretty sure that it's not modified. And that one will check my bootloader, possibly trusted execution environment. That one will check the kernel in RAMFS, and that one will check the file system. And maybe on my file system, I have a Docker instance that will check my Docker images. So I have the full chain of software components authenticated. So I did an implementation as a open embedded BB class, basically, which handles the signing and key loading part. And I put it up on my GitHub. It's used by a few customers of ours, and I basically extracted that from their custom BSPs because I want to move that into something more commonly used. So the basic ideas of that were something we did, I think, 1.5 years ago in PDX test, and it worked well there, and so we ported it over to Open Embedded. So currently in there we have support for Bearbox, for Linux, and for Raug, but the actual code in each image in each component recipe is pretty small, which you are going to see soon. So I have a BB class, which provides the infrastructure. And the basic concept is that you define specific roles for each key. So you load keys from the file system during development and specify a role for that. But you can also, using local configuration, provide a PKCS11 URI for each role to use a real HSM. But the using recipe doesn't see any difference between the emulated PKCS11 token with a local key and the real one. So we use soft HSM to provide for development cases. Yeah, so in the case of loading development keys, we have a simple recipe for each set of keys, which I call provider. So it's a native bitback package, which loads files from the source URI and defines a role and imports them to the soft HSM. And the resulting database is stored as a development or a native package. So I can use it later when I need to sign my packages. And I can define several different roles in this way and refer to them via virtual packages. So we did several examples for Bearbox and Fit and Raug, and each of these selects a specific key by its role, and then environment variables are defined. So I can pass these PKCS11 URIs to the, for example, the Bearbox build system or Ubuntu build system. They all take these URIs as input to access the keys. So the title is wrong. But so this is a simple example for Raug, our updater. So you inherit signings, so you get these shell functions. Make sure that you use the keys in the development package and an additional tool to get a certificate from PKC11, because that's not standardized. That's a helper we took from the Linux kernel, which they also use to extract cells from PKCS11. So we set up our shell infrastructure, select the key to use, and then these variables are defined. So in this case, I extract the certificate, put it into a file, and convert this file via OpenSSL, so Raug uses it at its trust anchor when verifying updates. So this is for generating the package which contains Raug binary. And this is the other side for signing when I have created a bundle. I need to access the key itself, and Raug just use these variables to access the key during signing and attach the signature to the bundle. And for fit images, it basically looks the same. I select a different role, use the PKCS11, the Ubuntu image tool doesn't want this prefix, so I strip it, and basically the rest works the same. There are definitely further use cases, so I'd like to hear about them. If that's interesting, Mark. Hey, Mark.
How does this plug into verifying the bootloader by Bootrum? Because usually each and every single vendor has their little tool which generates something which kind of interacts with the Bootrum and it kind of adds something to the bootloader block. And usually this tool is closed source because there is some special internal secret in it as well.
Yeah.
So
the question is how this integrates with verifying the bootloader from this the boot ROM, because there are vendor-specific tools for that. So far, I've only done that for the NXP IMX HAB High Assurance Boot. And they have a tool where you get source code for the wrapper, basically, and it contains also a closed source library. But the part accessing the keys is in the open source part. So also on the GitHub thing I posted, there's a patch for this IMX code signing tool, which teaches it about PKCS11.
So I can compile that on my desktop Mix machine?
Sorry?
So I can use that on my desktop Mix machine, or is that not possible?
No, because NXP doesn't provide the static library for MIPS. But there are people, I think, from Inverse Path who have re-implemented that signing tool. But I haven't tried that implementation. So yeah, that is going to be different in every SOC.
And do all these like special vendor tools support this PKCS11 keys bundles, or are they like using different format each and every of them?
I have only looked at the NXP thing, and they even tried it in the new version to implement PKCS11 in support itself themselves, but they did it wrong. So it wasn't useful in that version, but PKCS11 is the standard method to access HSMs. So if they implement something like that at all, it's probably going to be PKCS11. Yeah.
Is there any like configuration required on the host machine to enable this? I assume that.
For PKCS11 or for my signing configuration?
Well, your signing configuration interfaces with.
Yeah.
If you have a TPM of the host machine, you need to.
So there is. In the standard distributions, PKCS11 libraries are already there as P11 kit. I think it's done by Red Hat people, which is basically a multiplexer between different tokens and software implementations. And they have short configuration snippets where you say, this is my vendor or HSM vendor specific PKCS11 library, please hook into that, and then it will find those tokens. So it to access the keys, it uses the host libraries already installed on the system. Because there's no real other way.
So just a couple of questions here to see if I understand. We're working with the NXP, with the NXAVM Mini. So it sounds very similar with the HAM.
Yeah, it's the same.
Yeah, and what we're looking at doing is we want to work with our YubiKeys. So we've got a private key or intermediary signed key off that in the YubiKey. We have that plugged in. Then that will be pulled out transparently with all of this.
Yeah.
And that will then go to sign the artifacts that we use to put down onto the board. And we'll blow what the e-fuse is in the IMX to take that and to use that here. And we'd have maybe some dev boards, which would be blown against the dev key, and then the prod boards would be blown against the user key that we keep in the safe.
Yeah, exactly that.
Is there any way of doing multi-key signing, so that you need more than one YubiKey to sign a binary to be released? Do you know, so we're not dependent on like one person with one key?
YubiKey does not support, that would need to be supported by the ROM code, because then it would need to verify multiple signatures, so that's not supported.
So
but if you have a HSM, which supports requiring authentication by multiple people before you allow signatures, then you still get one signature, but only allow the HSM to generate that signature if you have multiple people present.
Okay, so we sort of take it one step back in
that
sense. And if I may, the other question was, and particularly with sort of NXP's implementation of the high availability boot, we're trying to sort of understand quite a lot of different things here that are new to us in the world of security. And what is that we're recommended the best practice is now to lay down a secure element on the board that we're putting together. So we have NXP's SEO5.0 on there, which again is doing all of this and has this internal private key that comes pre-programmed on the reel before we make the board. We have no access to that. That seems very useful, but the problem is that you know, we can rely upon that pod to give a sort of cryptographically assured identity for any given board individually as we try to onboard into the cloud. But also, as you say here, you know, we need chain of trust from PowerOn.
Yeah.
And what we want to do, it feels like the sensible thing to do is to be able to rely upon that pod, which has been manufactured to be physically protected against decapping and all the rest of it. But we can't do that because the NXP pod is relying upon this kind of eFuse-based hub process. And it feels like what the ROM code should be doing is going out over the I2C bus to talk to the SEL501 boot. I mean, that makes sense. Two different sets.
The problem is that the external part can't really verify that the SOC is booting the correct image. So the SOC would tell it, I'm booting this hash U-boot.
Indeed.
And yeah, it would need to trust it. So that's basically what the TPM does.
But the ROM code in the IMX8M is internally checking and assuring you against what it's booting, yeah? But it feels like it would be more secure for it to go to the external secure element and to use that for its, because we've got two roots of trust in the system.
I don't think it would, you would need to use both, basically.
Yeah, well, so, indeed, yeah.
So to ensure that the correct software is running, you have the chain starting at HIB, and then you have the identity in the separate module. Okay. That's basically orthogonal aspects of your security.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
So, any opinions if this should be a separate layer? In the beginning, probably yes. Should that go into OE core or meta OE or something like that?
I would keep it in a separate layer. What's the state of security layers? Do we have anywhere it makes sense?
Security.
But there's so many different definitions of security.
Yeah.
It's above my pay grade. I'm not very good at security.
Yeah, we've looked at MetaSecure Core a couple times. I just pinged Tom because he's tinkered with it. And he says it's sort of gone stale because the original developer has, I think it was Alibaba and he moved on and stuff, but he still does stuff. But I guess Wind River had been poking at it too. So I don't know if we want to try and get it to a better state, maybe, or think about moving some stuff to meta security, maybe, instead. It's very contentious because every time this comes up about trying to get one security layer, everybody decides they have different use cases. So,
yes, so this. Yes. Okay, so I haven't found that.
Yeah, I think ARM had moved some stuff from MetaMeasure to MetaSecurity, though. I thought it was the last go around that happened.
Okay, yeah.
We're putting some stuff into the next kernel, which in support for that's going to go into MetaMeasure.
Okay.
So you're going to do it again.
Yeah, so maybe for the beginning, I'll just make this a real layer and people can open GitHub issues and tell me it's broken or something.
The MetaSecure Core, I believe, is actually integrity stuff in it too, so it's not entirely a slam dunk, but it's being one place.
There's a next case you deal with, I'm sure.
Oh.
Yeah, okay. Any other questions? Something I should do?
Great.
Okay.